A very good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to this student alumni panel discussion. So without any further ado, let's commence the panel discussion with the first topic of today being trends and advancements in automotive and manufacturing industries. But before we start the proceedings, I would like to introduce our esteemed panel for this discussion and shed some light on their achievements. Shri Saurabh Yadav, our alumnus of 2003 batch, Saurabh sir is Director, Purchasing and Supplier Network at BMW with strong business experience in the areas of purchasing, cross-cultural environment and leading large multi-location teams. Shri Sandeep Sachdeva, our alumnus of 1990 batch, he has worked with some top-notch companies like Escorts, HCIL. In his career, he has acquired a vast experience, especially in the field of complete vehicle quality, market quality and powertrain quality. He is currently Operation Head, Quality Function with Honda Cars India Limited. Shri Vikram Singh, who's currently AGM after sales service in Hero MotoCorp, with extensive knowledge on big and challenging markets like Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Jharkhand, Bihar, and many more. Vikram sir too is an alumnus of this very university of 1919 batch. And Shri Kapil Agarwal, Head of Quality and Business Excellence at Apollo Tyres Limited and an alumnus of 1919 batch. He has a vast experience of 20 years with demonstrated history in quality and business excellence. We would also like to express our gratitude to each and every alumni present today for sparing their valuable time for this discussion. With this, I hand over the baton to my fellow mate, who will now give you an overview on how the discussion is supposed to go. Over to you, Thurana.
Thank you, Shine. Now, some important pointers before we dive into the discussion. As per the format, each panelist will express their views in 5 minutes. The last minute will be utilized by the speaker for delivering his concluding remarks. The discussion will be followed by a questionnaire round of 10 minutes. Any questions regarding the discussion are to be written in the chat window. They will be answered once the discussion is over. The audience is requested to keep their video and mic off unless instructed otherwise. With this said, let us begin the panel one discussion. Now, handing over the mic to the first speaker, Saurabh sir. Saurabh Yadav, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. You can hear me well?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You can hear? Okay. First of all, thank you, Anil sir, for inviting and giving a chance to interact with the fellow colleagues and seniors and the students in the university, and also giving a chance to see many of the known faces from my seniors from the MOB as well. And also thank you to giving me the chance to speak first. क्योंकि ये तो रिवायत है कि कवि सम्मेलन में या कहीं पे भी सबसे छोटे किरदार को सबसे पहले बोलने का मौका देते हैं. And I'm really look more than speaking. I'm looking forward to listening to Sachdeva sir, who is a very eminent speaker and very experienced person, and Vikram sir and Kapil sir as well. So coming to the subject, advancement in the automotive sector, in the manufacturing sector, I would largely focus on the automotive world in this regard. I joined automotive sector just after I went out of YMCA in 2003. So these are around 17 years completely in the automotive and also in automotive in the car business. BMW, I'm serving since last 10 years. And before that, I've experienced working with certain other OEMs in different locations, different part of the world. The good thing that happened during these 15, 17 years is that these have remained, and most of you will agree with me, that these have remained one of the most innovative and interactive and interesting times in the automotive world. The car that was visible to us, at least through the YouTube and through the different media channels in 1930, 1940, and the car that we could see in 1990 and 2000 were almost very, very, very similar. The most of the innovation after a gap of 50, 60, 70 years, the innovation started happening towards 2006, 7, 8. And of course, now we are sitting at the top of the peak. And if we can call it top of the peak. I would just for the respect of the time, I'll focus on 3-4 areas where I think the most of the innovations or most of the shift of the pattern is happening in the automotive world, in the car world. And as the very well-known buzz word, SS, the autonomous car, the connected car, the shared car, and the electric car. So these are the four things that I think are driving most of the innovation around the automotive world. Starting with the first, the autonomous car, the easy thing to say is that the dream that the world is looking right now towards the towards the autonomous car is 3 years back, 4 years back, it was even beyond imagination to the people who were doing it. As we call it easily, the term from L1 to L5, L1 being means you are driving the car, your hands are on the steering and your eyes are on the panel and to the road, means hands are on and eyes are on. Then you travel from L1 to L2 to L3 to L5. L5 is basically hands are off, legs are off, mind is off, and even the driver is off. So the car can handle the whole journey itself. It means going to the market, going to the airport, dropping you off, coming back, picking something from the grocery store, and coming back home and parking itself. Not with you, but maybe with your cat or with your dog. So that is L5. I think the future of L5 is still few years away, though there are very, very strong innovations happening in this ground. But at least the L4 level, where hands are off, mind is off, and the leg is off, and even in the crucial turns and in the accidental areas, the car performs better than the qualified F1 driver. This is a very reachable zone. And speaking specifically about my company, BMW, we are already doing L3 level, and we'll be in market with the L4 level of product in next 2.5 to 3 years. So there's a very strong push in this regard. Second, please remind me about the time if I jump over. Regarding the connectivity, connectivity is one of the newest subject out of these four. And right now, the car has to be connected throughout from all the four areas. And connection to the fellow cars, connection to a pedestrian who is walking on the road or aside the road, connection to the car, to the dogs and the cows in this, in our cases, and connection to your dealer, to your service station, to your families, to your offices and so on. So the car has to be completely connected throughout with your outer environment. It is one subject that has gained the maximum momentum in the last years. I can give you a very good example. Last year in the month of December, I mean 7-8 months back, we did one from my office, we did one exercise in India where we said, come over. If you're a university, you are a freelancer, you are a student, you are an established company, you are a garage operated company, come and give us idea about three things. So my car, my city, my life. And any kind of digital idea that connects the car in any way to the outer world, you are welcome to be a part of BMW ecosystem. I was so surprised to see, means these kind of ideas are working very well in countries like Israel and Korea and Japan and some part of USA. In India, I was so surprised that in a span of 3 weeks, we got around 500 nominations from different channels. So this is also one area where I was personally not as convinced that India might offer that much of input. And very surprisingly, we could finalize around 7 to 8 people who will be working with BMW Group in the coming months and coming years. Third is regarding the electrification. I think it's a very easy, easy subject to understand. And the way the world is moving towards the electrification is well understood. And even the debate is now getting lesser and lesser. What is a better fuel model for the cars?
Excuse me, sir?
Yes.
Sir, about 4.5 minutes have gone by. So keeping the time constraint. Yes, sir. You can take about 1.5 minutes more. Yes, sir. Sure. It's, okay, because it's really interesting. We also want to hear you. Yes, sir.
Right. So I will not talk about this electrification much, but as a summary, I can say that the debate is not about electrification or a regular combustion engine. The proposition the automotive market right now look forward is the power of choice. I mean, if I like a car of any manufacturer, do I have the flexibility to choose the same car in electric, in combustion engine, and in as a plug-in hybrid, PHEV, for example. So this is the power of choice that is emerging. And finally, the shared, I think very similar what we said, connected. Shared is Uber, for example. No too much word to say about it, also respecting the time. Thank you very much. And these are my very initial remarks about these subjects. Yes, back to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your opinion about all the four main topics that you have discussed. I'm sorry, due to the time constraint, we couldn't give you the appropriate time required. But it was really great, sir, hearing you. Now, I would like to move on to Shri Sandeep Sachdeva, sir. Sir,
yes, I could be able to unmute it.
Once again, thank you, sir.
Very good afternoon to everybody present today. First of all, I would like to pay my regards to our Vice Chancellor Ji, Dr. Dinesh Ji. And then I have been to a great extent associated with Raj Bhatia Ji because of my very long stay in this job. Thank you, Bhatia Ji, for supporting us under different circumstances throughout as our very eminent supplier. Anil Ji, sir, you have always been an inspiration for all of us. Then all my fellow panelists, Subhash Ji, thank you very much for giving such a beautiful insight into what automation is and how it can be useful to the society. Vikram Ji and Kapil Ji, we are looking forward to actually also listen to you. Probably we'll also get very good information from you also. There is a request, and once again, good afternoon to all our students from our very eminent institute. Can I share a PPT presentation with you? And if it is possible, how can I do it? Can somebody guide me?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, you are the co-host now, and you can share your screen.
Host can do it.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yeah. Yes, it is very much.
Okay, in our car industry, not even in the car industry, everywhere, it is the customer who is considered as the boss, because that is how it is the customer which actually decides whether we should exist in this society or not. So the customer's expectations, as you all know, it is the very high level of quality at a very low cost is not the right word. Sometime the cost may not be the lowest, but it should be reasonable cost. And then a timely and fast delivery, which actually makes us think about how much value for money our customer is getting. So this is about our internal customers who actually use our end products, let it be anything. But internally, where we are working, in Japanese we call it Gemba, our workplace. Here also we have to take care of who all are working there, so as to they should also feel like while working they are also gaining something. They are getting educated with every day, they are getting their skilled up every day. They really enjoy working. It is not like they, at the end of the day they found themselves totally drawn with zero energy, and then their results are good results, and they are sustainably good results. So with this industry keeping this in mind, and there are other factors also that I'll discuss later. You know that we have gone through various different changes, I mean different stages we call. These days it is called Industry 4.0 that we are heading for. So very from the earlier stages of manual labor, we have changed to using the electronic components into our machinery and equipment. Then came the digitization, wherein the computer software and numerically controlled machines have taken the charge, and now we are looking for a place wherein we call the Industry 4.0 that actually emphasize on digital technology from recent decades to a whole new level with the help of interconnectivity through the Internet of Things, IoT that we say, so as to have the access to the real-time data and introduction of cyber-physical system. To say what cyber-physical system is like, it's a computer system in which a mechanism is controlled or monitored by a computer-based algorithm. And in cyber-physical system, physical and software components are deeply intertwined, able to operate and interact with each other in a way that they themselves change according to the context, according to the changing situation. Like as earlier been explained by Saurabhji, that the autonomous driving, then we know that far from workplace, we can control our industry also. That is the remote industrial control system. Robotics itself is a part of this 4.0, and we all very well know about the automatic pilot in avionics. So these are some of the examples, but here it is not going to end. I mean, this is not the last. Future, we are looking at, Mr. Ram Rahim, do you want to ask anything? Okay.
We will not entertain any questions. We'll entertain the questions after discussion, sir.
Okay, somebody raised the hand, it seems.
Okay, please write in the chat box whoever has raised the hand. I'm sorry to cut you off, sir. You can now continue. You have around 1.5 minutes or so remaining.
Okay. So these things, I mean, apart from these things, there are other regulations and things like that. They actually also influence what in future is required. So like regulations in the emission norms, these are there wherein we are heading towards from petrol, diesel, BS4, BS6 norms, and now to the hybrid electrical vehicles and then electrical vehicles. So this is also driving the change in the technology. You can see the safety. The more we are concerned now towards safety of the occupant of the car, the vehicle, and the pedestrians also, those who are outside the car. So these things are also driving the changes, and these changes, when, as you know, that we are shifting from petrol, diesel now to HEV and then BEV. So, and this is not the all. We are also going through various changes in the raw material itself. The material is the whole vehicle is made from normal steel to high tensile steel, and then the process changes from normal stamping to hot stamping, partial hot stamping, and then other things like material. Now we are switching away from steel to aluminium, magnesium, and not even that, even the reinforced material also. So all these changes, to have those changes for during the next 10 years, they are going to happen. So who all are going to do these, take care of these changes? It is only our our young talented engineers that are coming out of their universities from now. So we all are looking at you people for these changes. And yes, then this automation has already been discussed earlier by Sorabson, so I won't touch it. And then the whole process of manufacturing is also going to get changed. This is the normal way we have developed. We used to develop a model which takes about 2 to 3 years. Now you see from concept, then mock making, then prototype making, then line trials, and then finally we go into the mass production. But you see this area where I'm talking about this, because of these requirements, it has, I mean, to a great extent, it has gone undergone a very huge change. The normal way, the conventional way of working is to have a very high cost prototype made, very long lead time to work with it, and then the verification itself won't give the very good results. So this now is getting changed through various, the 4.0 tools that we have right now in our industry, wherein we use the virtual simulations to actually see to it whether the equipment tools that we use will suit without going through any physical trial.
Excuse me, sir. Sir,
you are unmute everybody. Only allow the.
Yes, sir. I will. Please, Sumit sir and all the hosts, please take care of this. And yes, sir. Sandeep Sajdeva, sir. Really sorry, sir. You are over the time limit. We really want you to continue, but sorry, we are constrained. It's for everybody now. Very sorry, yes. Sir. So any concluding line, sir?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Concluding line is here. That,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What we actually, all these changes, who will do it for us? It is you young engineers. See, I mean, this is the latest, just an example for all of us to see to it that even a young, a new sport car has been designed and led by a design engineer who is just 24, 25 years old. So age is no bar. Basically, how the person has been nurtured during their learning period is more important. So I would like you all to really see to it that how you can become leaders, because you can think of future better than anybody else. So please stay there with this mission of yours to lead the whole industry in coming times and give the best out of you. Thank you very much. Sorry for taking more time. Yes, please, I hand over
students.
Back
to the... Nikhil?
Sumit?
Sir, sorry, I think Turan is encountering some network problems. So,
okay.
So no issue, sir. It was a very enlightening discussion. And now I hand over the mic to Mr. Vikram Yadav, sir, for the next expert opinion.
Right. Thank you very much. Am I audible and visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Saurabh and Sandeep ji, for setting the context for today's meeting by sharing your insights on the trends in the automotive industry. And also, I would like to thank Anil Bareja, sir, for giving us the opportunity to have a discussion on the emerging trends in the various industries. So certainly, this is going to be a good platform for all the members who are participating in this meeting. So a very good afternoon to all our organizations, Vice Chancellor, sir, all alumni, faculty members, and my young members of the YMCA family. I do hope that you all and with your family members are safe and healthy in such a challenging time. Now, just before moving to the insights toward the two-wheeler industry, just I want to brief about my working in the two-wheeler industry and about the company in which I am working. So I am in the two-wheeler industry for the last 20 years. Currently, I'm in the Hero Motor Corp Limited, and earlier I was in Yamaha Motor India. So my major working experience is related to the after sales service. So I used to work in the some bigger and the challenging markets of the country. And about HMCL, there are 600 touch points. That is the biggest network of any automobile company. And moreover, this is the only company in the world in two-wheeler, which is number one in the 20th year in a row. There are six manufacturing plants in India and two outside Bangladesh and Colombia. So this was all about the automobile and about myself. Now just I come on to the topic of this emerging trends. If we go into the figures of the two-wheeler industry, then you will see that for the last 15 years, the numbers are on year basis, the numbers are increasing. Like if I give the example of financial year 11, then the two-wheeler industry was having the figure of 11.71 million. Then that figure reaches to 21.18 million in financial year 19. Although in the financial year 20, because you are very much aware for the known reasons, the industry gets shrink, gets some dip. So there was almost 18% drop in that area. So when we start the journey, you can say the hero just start the journey with a four-stroke. At that time, you are very much aware. At that time, the two-stroke was the major player. Rajdoot and RX-100, all the major players were there in that two-wheeler industry. Thereafter, this trend changes to the four-wheeler, and entire automobile two-wheeler manufacturing companies shifted themselves to the four-stroke technology. Thereafter, some changes in the, as per the emission norms, changes were there on the regular intervals. Like in the recent years, you have seen that all the automobile manufacturers were upgraded from BS3 to BS4. And in this current year, directly just we had a frog jump from BS4 to BS6. So that was again a big change, because if I go for the two-wheeler industry, then BS4 to BS6 is one of the major change. Like because there is the FI technology. FI technology is not a new word for the car industry, but in the two-wheeler industry, FI fuel injection technology is a new norm for that that industry. And that is going to, that is one of the biggest change we have seen in the two-wheeler industry till date. One more trend which is emerging as of now, that is about the rising trend of the scooters. If you go into the sales figure, as of now in the India, almost in every 100 two-wheelers, there are 32 scooters in every two-wheeler, every 100 two-wheeler which are sold. So this part is increasing year on year. For the last, if just I talk about 2011, then the scooter percentage was in single digit. Nowadays, this trend is emerging because of the college students, because of the women and girls adaptability towards the scooters, then this new trend is emerging. So nowadays, in entire two-wheeler portfolio, the motorcycle is having the 64% contribution, 32% contribution is for the scooters, and 4% is from the moped like TVS and all that. Another emerging trend which are coming about this electric bikes. Although in the electric bikes, we are at the very starting point, because in the last year, only 24,000 two-wheelers which are electric vehicles were sold. So, but this trend is emerging, and entire two-wheeler companies are ready with their electric vehicles. Might be because there was huge expense in this BS4 to BS technology, BS6 technology. Then certainly they will wait for another few more years, and then they will come up with a big bang in the electric vehicles also. So I do expect that in the coming 4 or 5 years, then the electrical vehicles will capture a good percentage of the total two-wheelers which are going to be sold in the India, in India country or abroad. Then one more trend which is emerging about the premium vehicles. Premium in the sense the vehicle which are higher in the CC. Earlier, almost 80% of the vehicles which were sold in India were having the entry segment, like 100cc, 125cc. But nowadays, this trend is going, do it change? Every new buyer is just aiming for Royal Enfield, for Harley Davidson, for the premium bikes of Hero, for the premium bikes of Bajaj and all that. So that is one of more trend which is now coming into the picture. Other than that, after sales service is going to be a big differentiator in the coming time. The company which is going to provide a better service, certainly that will be having the upper hand among all the competitors, self-job cart, roadside assistance, pick up and drop. Then there are some app development for the sake of the customer comfort, which are already there in the car industry, but in the two-wheeler industry, these are just new norms. And now the industry is inclined towards introducing these type of initiatives in their own companies also. So these are few of the changes which happened in the last year, in the last few years, and the part which is going to be in the coming year is about the electric vehicles. One more important point is about the
Sorry for cutting you off, but unfortunately there is a time constraint. Yeah. I hope you understand.
Yeah, just I'm putting up a concluding remark
okay.
only.
Okay.
Just in India, about 102 out of 1,000 people have two wheelers, which is very less as compared to other countries. Like in Indonesia, it is 281 per 1,000. In Thailand, it is 291 per 1,000. So in India, there is a huge potential. There is a huge scope for the penetration. So I do hope in the coming 5 years, as per the emerging trend, the two-wheeler industry will get itself double in the coming 5 to 6 years. So this is all about from my side about the two-wheeler. Thank you very much for giving me the time, and thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very informative opinion, and now we'll move up forward to our next panelist, Kapil sir. Please, sir. Is Kapil sir in the?
Kapil, you are on mute.
So I would request Kapil sir to please unmute. Kapil sir? Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are
yeah,
good.
Yeah. Very good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thanks to VC sir. I would like to thanks to Mr. Bareja sir and the all the organizers who create this platform to have a meeting and in be in front of you for a small time for sharing the views from the different parts of the industry. And really this is a very good moment for me because I'm getting an opportunity to meet Mr. Sandeep Sajdeva-san, whom I used to interact way back in 2005 without knowing that he is my college senior. I interacted Saurabh for a couple of months into one of my previous industry. Vikram is my classmate when we used to be in the same roommates in the hostel 20 years back. So it was a very interesting moment at this point of time. So coming back to the topic, so currently I am working with a tire industry called Apollo Tires. Apollo Tires is India's the second largest tire manufacturer. Apollo is having a presence across the India with 5 plants. 1 plant into Europe, 1 plant into Netherlands. So total we have 7 manufacturing plants. And it is the not. So it's a very large company, and we are into all the verticals of tires except what I say is aeroplane tires. So other than aeroplane tires, we are into all the other verticals of tire. And currently I work with the Vadodara plant, and we produce tires for off the road tires, what is called OTR, what you see into the JCB and the mining industries, etc. So we are into the passenger car tires. We are into the truck commercial TBB, what we call as a truck bus tires, a farm tractor, and the two-wheeler tires. Recently, we had a new product range into the tire, which is called as a 0-degree steel radial. And what my earlier speakers have informed at a high-speed bikes. So that is one of the product of the high-speed bikes, which is growing almost in India at a rate of 20% growth rate. So I'll just take you to the some of the details about the tire industry, because it's a very niche for most of us, because I never came across with anyone who is into the tire industry from my college. The tire plants are usually very big plants where there are nearly 3,000, 4,000 employees working. So just about the India in the tire industry, there are 41 tire companies. Into these 41 tire companies have total 66 tire plants. And the industry is as big in size as of 60,000 crore. And out of this 16,000 crores, nearly 13,000 crore tires are exported from the different markets, including US, Europe, and other ASEAN countries. And the industry is having a general of 8 to 10% of the growth. It's nearly growing by the growth rate of almost 10%. Nearly in India, we produce 20 crore tires in a year. It's by all together across all the industries. This much number is produced all together. And as if we go to the segment, the 40% is in volume in numbers is motorcycle, 23% is passenger car tires, 17% is the scooter tires, 10% is the truck bus, and the commercial and the farm are nearly 10%. So if we go by the revenue, the truck bus gives the 54% of the revenue, the passenger car gives the 14%. Followed by the 13% two-wheeler and rest others. So that is about the size of the industries. And nearly 15% we export, which is nearly 3.5 crore tires a year. And there is a substantial reduction into the import numbers. Almost year on year, we are getting in a 13% reduction into the tire numbers. And nearly this is 3.5 crore tires a year. If we talk on the technologies, we have a...
Sorry for interrupting, sir. We would really, really love you to go on, but actually there's a time constraint, unfortunately. I hope you understand.
Okay. So going on the technology into the tire, the way we are forwarding towards the radialization into the tire industry. The radialization in the tire industry is the car segment is having almost 98-90% radialization. The truck bus is having a radialization of 50%, and the commercials are around 40% of the radialization. So as of the new coming technologies into the passenger car segment, the commercial segment, the truck segment, there is a substantial change into the technologies into the tire industry. We are shifting from bias to cross ply tire to the radialization, and the latest technologies into the tire is like RFID chip based tires are coming. So this is very important with the perspective of the operator, user, and the tire manufacturer. All the tires are related to the vehicle maintenance, the tire handling, the tire life predictions. All everybody can get into the through the smart apps and all that, and this is leading to the more efficient, fuel efficient tires with delivering a high mileage and all that. So that is how the tire industry is. So it's a growing industry, and it's a really very opportunity and a profitable industry. If somebody wants to look towards this as an then this is rubber is one of the most profitable, and the prices and all of the imports and are also rubber prices are also going down, so it gives a pretty good margin to the oil, to the all the tire manufacturers. And the plants are having a very high level of automation because of the technologies, because of the product requirements, because of the customer requirement from the OEM and the others. So that is how the industry is moving ahead. So that's all from my side.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very enlightening talk. Now, with this, we conclude our panel discussion. And now we will be moving over to the questioner round. And I hope that there are some questions in the chat box. Okay. So we start with the first question. Sir, knowing that the competition is very high nowadays, what do you think skill knowledge by MCSU students, 2020 freshers, learn or slash know to grab job in automobile MNCs? This is a question asked by Pankaj Bora, and it is addressed to Mr. Saurabh Yadav, sir. Sir, Saurabh sir, please.
देखो दोस्त इस क्वेश्चन पहले तो मैं आंसर से पहले क्वेश्चन को ठीक कर देता हूँ. सबसे पहले तो ये माइंडसेट से थोड़ा सा चेंज करना पड़ेगा कि हमें क्या पढ़ें कि हमें नौकरी मिले, है ना. अगर इसको आप ग्लोबल पर्सपेक्टिव पे, मैं इसके आंसर पे भी आता हूँ, तो पूरी चाहे वो ऑटोमोटिव इंडस्ट्री हो या बाद में और भी एक्सपर्ट बोलने वाले हैं काफी इंडस्ट्री से, किसी भी यूनिवर्सिटी को एज एन एंटिटी या किसी भी स्टूडेंट को एज अ पर्सन, सबसे पहले ये देखना पड़ेगा कि आप कहाँ पे कैसे इस पूरे इकोसिस्टम में वैल्यू ऐड कर सकते हो. मैंने ऐसे लोगों को भी बहुत अच्छे प्रोफाइल पे, बहुत अच्छी अपर हायरार्की में देखा है, जिनके एजुकेशन बैकग्राउंड बहुत ज्यादा स्ट्रॉन्ग नहीं है, लेकिन वो पर्सनली बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग वैल्यू ऐड करते हैं. दूसरा ये कि हमें, कमिंग टू डायरेक्टली टू द क्वेश्चन, ये भी देखना पड़ेगा कि मेरे को तो अभी करिकुलम का पता नहीं है, लेकिन क्या आउटसाइड एनवायरनमेंट ऑटोमोटिव का जिस स्पीड से चेंज हो रहा है, क्या हमारे करिकुलम उस स्पीड से चेंज हो रहे हैं या नहीं हो रहे हैं. अगर हम आज भी पिस्टन रिंग और इंजन वॉल पढ़ रहे हैं मेजोरिटी ऑफ द सेमेस्टर्स में उसको ऑटोमोटिव इंजीनियरिंग समझ के, तो ये तो फंडामेंटल मिस्टेक हम कर ही रहे हैं. क्योंकि आप जब अपना एक सेमेस्टर खत्म करते हो, उस टाइम तक इस तरह की इमर्जिंग टेक्नोलॉजी, जैसे हम एसीस की बात की या इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन की बात की, वो इंडस्ट्री आपकी स्पीड से बहुत आगे निकल चुकी होती है. आपको पता ही है कि इन चीजों में कितना इनोवेशन हो रहा है, तो करिकुलम का सही डिजाइन होना. और तीसरा जो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट है वो ये है कि अभी हमें ना इंडस्ट्री ने अपने डोमेन्स तोड़ दिए हैं. मतलब पहले ये लगता था ऑटोमोटिव इज फॉर मैकेनिकल, तो वो वाला डोमेन तोड़ दिया है, क्योंकि कनेक्टेड सर्विसेज और डिजिटलाइजेशन और ये सब चीजें आई हैं, तो मैकेनिकल वाला फील्ड ये रहा नहीं. तो क्या हम अपनी एजुकेशन में भी वो बैरियर तोड़ रहे हैं कि नहीं तोड़ रहे हैं? आज अगर एक प्रोग्रेसिव ऑटोमोटिव इंडस्ट्री 100 लोगों को हायर करती है फॉर द फ्यूचर नीड्स, तो हो सकता है उसके अंदर 80 लोग मैकेनिकल बैकग्राउंड के हो ही ना, वो आईओटी बैकग्राउंड के होंगे, सचदेवा साहब ने जैसे बताया, या फिर वो बिग डाटा पे क्या काम कर रहे हैं. मैं आपको एक बहुत छोटा सा एग्जांपल बताता हूँ. ये तो बड़े सिंपल हो गया कि पिस्टन और ये सब चीजें चेंज होंगी. गाड़ी का जो सीट का मटेरियल होता है, जिसको हम लेदर या आर्टिफिशियल लेदर या जो भी बोलते हैं उसको, वो वाली इंडस्ट्री भी आजकल बड़े खतरे में आ गई है. बिकॉज मटेरियल ऑल्सो हैज टू क्रिएट वैल्यू इन टू द कार, कि वो सिर्फ इसे लेने की हम उसके ऊपर बैठे हैं. तो जो इस इंडस्ट्री में जो लोग थे ना, जो पॉलीमर इस बैकग्राउंड के लोग थे, वो भी रिप्लेस हो रहे हैं. वो उनमें भी कह रहे हैं कि मटेरियल शुड स्पीक, और मटेरियल वो सेंसर्ड मटेरियल और इस तरह के आते हैं. मेरे कहने का मतलब ये है कि अगर हम अपने बैरियर्स नहीं तोड़ेंगे एजुकेशन के टाइम पे, तो और प्योर मैकेनिकल इंजीनियर या प्योर ऑटोमोटिव इंजीनियर बनेंगे, मेरे को लगता है वो थोड़ा सा रिस्की है. एंड लास्ट, मैं एक बुक पढ़ रहा था, सर्वाइवल ऑफ द ह्यूमनिस्ट, बहुत हमने पढ़े हैं सर्वाइवल फ्लेक्सिबल और ये सब कुछ. ये बेसिक स्किल है, वो पिछले 5000 सालों से नहीं टूटी. उसके बेस के ऊपर टेक्नोलॉजी बैरियर्स को तोड़ के पढ़ाई का स्ट्रक्चर होगा, तो वैल्यू एड ज्यादा होगी, लेकिन वैल्यू एड के ऊपर ध्यान देना चाहिए.
थैंक यू सो मच सौरभ सर. नाउ लेट्स मूव ऑन टू द सेकंड क्वेश्चन. दिस इज आस्क्ड बाय संचित फ्रॉम सेकंड ईयर. How the sensors are in a broad spectrum, driverless cars are going to face potholes and generic mindset of traffic rules, breaking of people in our country. I'd like to pitch this question to Mr. Sandeep Sachdeva, sir. Sandeep, sir, please, if you could enlighten us with your views.
As we are talking about autonomous driving, but if you had any chance to sit in a car which is supposed to be an autonomous driven car, or semi-autonomous driven car, wherein few of the features of autonomous driving has been applied, the first thing as you switch on the car comes onto the screen is that at the end, the responsibility is on to the onus is on to the driver, who is on to the steering. That is the reason. This is the reason why, because autonomous, as you rightly said, can only work in at the moment. The whatever progress have been made can only work in certain limited conditions, like to say auto parking. That's very simple example. There are 6 to 8 radars all over the car. Then there are micro milli radars. Then there are sensors which are fitted onto the car, which actually sense and read the surrounding. And what do they read? They actually identify, is there any hindrance around? Then they identify whether the place where we have reached is a designated parking place. That means there are certain indications on the floor which decides this is the parking place, like certain lines. So all these things in an environment put together can only make the autonomous driving successful. So as you rightly said, that if the rules are not obeyed, then probably the autonomous driving itself cannot be put into its total perspective. And this is the reason, this is one of the reason why at the moment there still we are struggling, the whole world is struggling, every other country is struggling, even America is struggling to form the official rules for autonomous driving. In case if some mishap happens, who will be held responsible? Whether the occupant of the car, the company that car that who has made the car, the designer. So all these things put into a comprehensive perspective is being debated upon at the moment. Till now, we don't have a very clear rules and regulation for autonomous driving. So in the bottom line is that what autonomous driving or not, rules are rules. If those are not respected, I mean, technology at the moment cannot take care of such irregularities. I hope I have made your query. I could be able to answer your query.
Yes, sir, definitely. That was very informative. And now let's move on to the third question. Which exactly, what are the resources required to rebuild manufacturing industries post-COVID? I would like Mr. Vikram Singh, sir, to please address this question. Vikram, sir, if you could please.
Yeah, certainly COVID-19 is a big challenge for the entire automobile industry, or you can say any industry which is existing, whether it is IT, automobile, any industry. So there will be some changes in the norms which the company is adopting. Moreover, like if I go for the automobile industry, then certainly they will be they will move towards robotic parameter much more as compared to the earlier period, because earlier they were using that in the assembly line and all that. They will try to ensure there will be some minimum contact in between the two persons who are operating on a line in the manufacturing, whether it is the engine line or assembly line or frame line. So there will be just intention will be just to minimize the contact in between the two persons who are working there. So certainly they will put in some autonomous, mechanism in that particular area, just to minimize that. And broad context, as of now, that is not going to be a bigger change. But yeah, keeping in view of this this challenging time, certainly the company has to, some innovate new method just to maintain the safety and security of the persons who are working in the company. So there will be some, you can say, some technology which are going to be emerged in the manufacturing sections where the proper distance can be maintained, where the low interference from the operators will be there. Now certainly that is going to be the new norm in that, although I will not be able to elaborate too much about that manufacturing part, but certainly that is going to be what I have told you. I think that will be in the part of the manufacturing.
I just only want to supplement over it is that this whole experience that we have faced during this COVID pandemic is going to further push or accelerate the application of Industry 4.0. See, remote controlling a factory a year back, working from home and for a manufacturing industry seemed impossible. If you had some emergency at home, you can take leave. There was no facility like work from home for a person who was working in the manufacturing line. But today things have changed. This have shown us that your physical presence is not absolute necessity onto the manufacturing line. So many of, that will also push, these automations that rightly said to a different level from now onwards. It is not only the volumes, but there will be many other factors now have factored in to decide whether automation is required or not. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you to both Sandeep sir and Vikram sir. Now let's move on to the last question of this discussion. Product mix by revenue is for industry or is it specific to Apollo? I think Mr. Kapil sir would be both more suited to answer this question. So yeah. Kapil sir, please.
So what I have described is overall Indian industry details. It is not specific to Apollo, but yes, the numbers of Apollo are little bit here and there with the, as per the industry tech, somewhere we are the market leader, somewhere we are at a second position or at a third position, but in totality that the numbers are the representative of the Indian tire industry. And like into the tire industry, there are different kind of product range. So by and large, everyone is not leader into the all the kind of industry, all the kind of verticals. Some is leading into the passenger car, some is leading into the commercial, some is leading into the two-wheeler segment. So that is how the industry operates. So in totality, we are at number two in the country with a slight margin, then MRF. And the numbers are all across more or less similar kind of thing for all the tire manufacturers into their respective fields.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, I can see more questions in the chat box, but unfortunately, due to time constraint, we cannot address all of them. So don't you worry, we'll address all of them, not in person, but in fact, through mails. So we will address your questions in some time. Now, to just conclude the meeting, I would really like to thank all the panelists because the opinions they have provided us were very insightful and very enlightening. To sum up what they have said, they have actually told us what lies in the future ahead, how the Industry 4.0 revolution will change the future, and what all changes are coming up in the automotive industry with new changes in electric industry also. Now with this, we will move on to the panel second. Now over to the panel second moderators.